I'm Jimmy Painter, and this is God's Word for today. Conversations with Christ. How we speak to God and how He speaks to us. That is the title of a new three-part series that we're going to begin today that focuses on our conversations with God and His conversations with us. Today in part one, we will examine effective prayer. And today's text is one verse, and what a verse it is. Mark chapter 11, verse 24. Jesus said, "Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours." This is an amazing promise from God. It is but one of over 7,000 personal promises that God makes to us in the 66 books of the Bible. And most of those promises are connected to prayer. When it comes to exercising effective prayer, we need to heed these three considerations. Here's consideration number one. We need to consider our fellowship, our fellowship. When we pray, we would be wise to take into consideration our fellowship with God, our connection to Him, the time we spend with Him, Him with us. Watch this now, our relationship with Him. It's not an intellectual relationship. Dare I say it? It's a passionate one. It's relational. It's a love relationship that we have with the Almighty. For God to hear and answer our prayers, we must first be saved from our sin through faith in Jesus. And once we have received Jesus as our Savior, God will hear and act. Watch this now. Only when we walk in a right relationship with Him and with other people. One anonymous writer penned these wise words. If we are honest, we must admit that much of our time is spent pretending. But when we turn to God in prayer, we must present our real selves candidly, acknowledging our strengths and our weaknesses and our total dependence upon Him. Let me break this down for you. God knows us. God knows us and God loves us. And God understands us. God understands our weaknesses. And God does not expect perfection. But if we knowingly continue to live lives of sin, harboring in our hearts sins that both please and pollute us. You got to get this now. God will not listen to our prayers. You say, well, Jimmy, that sounds kind of harsh. Harsh it may be, but biblical indeed it is. If we are out of fellowship with the Father, the Son will not give us what we prayed for, even when we pray those prayers in Jesus' name. So how do we fix that? Very simply, we repent. Now, what does that mean? Repent doesn't mean, hey, I feel guilty because I got caught. You know, it's like a small child in the kitchen that all of a sudden you're in the living room and you hear a noise, a rattle, if you will, happening in your kitchen. And you walk in and you flip on the light and you find Junior up on a stool with his arm up to his elbow in the cookie jar. And he starts to cry and he said, I'm sorry. He's sorry he got caught. That's not repentance. It's in the Greek, it is not metamelomai, to feel sorry that you got caught, but it is rather this word, metanoio. It means a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of attitude, a change of direction. Headed in that direction, spinning on your heel and coming the other way. We repent. That's how we fix the problem of being out of fellowship with God and being out of fellowship with other people. Being out of a healthy, dynamic relationship with God and in healthy, dynamic relationships with other people. We let go of garbage and we give it to God. We let go of our junk and we give it to Jesus. We get back on that radical right relationship with Jesus that we began when we were born again, living our lives as blood-bought, Bible-taught sons and daughters of the Most High God. Then we can pray in accordance with God's will, revealed in God's Word. You see, a lot of times there's such a mystery attached to all of that. But if we want to know if it's okay or what God wants, we just have to go to the Bible. It's revealed there for us. So we can pray in accordance to God's will, revealed in God's Word, and then we can claim that promise in Mark 11:24. Whatever we ask for in prayer, believing we've already received it. That's past tense. We've already got it. And it will be ours. And that's a promise from God, and God does not break His promises. Exercising effective prayer takes into consideration our fellowship, our relationship with God, the Heavenly Father. Effective prayer also takes into consideration number two. Let's take a look at this. If we want to have an effective and a powerful and an earth-shaking kind of prayer life, we need to take into consideration our request. You see, for some people, ending their prayers in Jesus' name seems like a magical formula that if they pray and they use these precise words, they can somehow force God's hand to do for them what God really doesn't want to do. We need to understand this, my brothers and sisters in Christ, and hear me, please. Nothing can force God's hand. God is God, and we are not. So to pray in Jesus' name, let me teach this for just a second. To pray in Jesus' name is to ask for that which is consistent with the will, the word, and the character of Christ. Let me say that again. To pray in Jesus' name is to pray a prayer that is consistently aligned with the will, the word, and the character of Christ. When we pray, we should pray in faith, believing that God is able to do whatever is in His will to do. And we should willingly submit all of that to Him. And let's just be honest about it. Sometimes it's a good thing we don't get what we ask for in Jesus' name. Mike Coghlan is a church planter. He's a church planting pastor whose church meets in a temporary building, and he tells the following story. During the usual chaos of setting up for worship, I heard one of my church members complain about his back hurting. And just before the service, his wife explained to me that Jack was recovering from some recent surgery. So during my pastoral prayer, Jack's name came to my mind. So I asked God to heal Jack and to help him to recover from his surgery and for God to restore him to full function. I heard a gasp and then some muffled laughter. Later, I found out after the service that Jack's service was a vasectomy. I'm sure Jack didn't want that prayer answered. D.L. Moody, that great preacher of another generation, said, "Spread out your petition before God and then say, 'Thy will be done, not mine.'" And then he said, "The sweetest lesson I have learned in God's school is to let the Lord choose for me." Wise counsel from a great prayer warrior. Effective prayer takes into consideration our request of God. Effective prayer finally takes into consideration consideration number three. And here it is. To have an effective prayer life, we must take into consideration our motive. What is our motive when we pray? God will not say yes to a prayer that will hurt us, hurt others, and will hurt both His purpose and His plan. Let me say that again. God will not say yes to a prayer that will hurt us, hurt others, and hurt His purpose and His plan. When we pray, it is important for us to check our motive. What's driving us to pray this prayer? Is the goal to glorify God and to let others see Him, show up and show off? Or is our motive selfish, self-centered, and sinful? Davy Troxell tells the following story. My 8-year-old son came home from school with a stuffed animal that he had won at the class Valentine party. So Davy said, I looked at my son and I said, so, hey, how did you win that? And he said, well, the teacher put all of our names together and then picked one out. And then his son said, but I cheated, I guess. I prayed. Cute, right? An 8-year-old's cute prayer. But what happens when that is a life-altering kind of prayer from someone who is, shall we say, a bit more mature? Consider, if you will, the following case study provided for us by that great theologian, Garth Brooks. Garth writes, just the other night at a hometown football game, my wife and I ran into my old high school flame. And as I introduced them, the past came back to me, and I couldn't help but think of the way things used to be. She was the one that I'd wanted for all times, and each night I'd spend praying that God would make her mine, and that if He'd only grant me this wish I wished back then, I'd never ask for anything again. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs that just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. She wasn't quite the angel that I remembered in my dreams, and I could tell that time had changed me in her eyes too, it seemed. We tried to talk about the old days. There wasn't much we could recall. I guess the Lord knows what He's doing after all. And as she walked away and I looked at my wife, and then and there I thanked the good Lord for the gifts in my life. Yes, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs that just because he may not answer don't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. Not the greatest theology in the world, but does that sound familiar? You see, for a lot of us, we think that God hasn't heard us or hasn't answered us if His answer isn't yes. So how many of us have been there? How many of us right now are there? Effective prayer takes into consideration, watch this now, the motive in our prayer. Let me summarize this. When our fellowship with God is right, and when our request of God is right, and when our motive in our prayer is right, then we can focus all of the powers and all of the resources of God upon effective prayer. Maybe this will help. During Operation Desert Storm, the Iraqi war machine was overwhelmed by coalition forces' ability to strike strategic targets with never-seen-before accuracy. Unknown to the Iraqis, the Allied Supreme Command had dropped Special Operation Forces, SOF if you will, deep behind enemy lines. These soldiers provided bombing coordinates for military targets and firsthand reports of the effectiveness of subsequent bombing missions. To avoid unintended targets, pinpoint bombing was often required. A soldier in an SOF unit standing on the ground would request an aircraft high overhead to drop a laser-guided missile. And then using a handheld laser, the soldier would point at the target, and the missile would hone in on the soldier's target to hit. Now listen to me. Listen to me good. In much the same way, the prayers of Christian soldiers focus the attention of the spiritual powers of God on high. We can direct God in all of the resources of heaven. Our economy may be struggling, but God ain't broke. All power belongs to Him. And when we put into practice those three things that we've talked about today, we can come up against seemingly insurmountable obstacles. And as Smith Wigglesworth said so wonderfully so long ago, faith stares in the face of impossibility and laughs. Whatsoever you ask for in prayer, believing you have received it, that God has already given it to you, and it shall be yours. That is effective prayer. Let us exercise the audacity of faith and pray effective prayers.
Thank you for joining us today. We have one question for you today. You just heard an amazing sermon, so what are you going to do about it? The first step is to give your life to Christ. If you've never given your life to Christ, why not today? But you just don't get it by watching us today. You don't get it by rules or rituals. You get it by having a personal, real relationship with God. If you want that today, pray this with me right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. God, I give you my life. I give you total control of my life. I believe you are who you said you are, and I believe everything the Bible said you did. I ask you to come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for forgiveness today. I want to trust to follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen. If you pray that, God just came in into your heart to live inside of you. I want you to go right now to cresthill.org/connect to tell us about the decision you just made. This is means for a party. This is means for a celebration. Don't wait. Go to cresthill.org/connect. You'll be directed to our church's website, and then you'll just click the blue button that says connect. Fill out some information about yourself so that we can celebrate with you today about what you just did. Don't wait. Hit the blue button that says connect today. Also, if you say, hey, I know about Jesus, but I want to find a church home, you can be a part of Crestal's fellowship wherever you are across the globe. So go to crestal.org/connect to be a part of our Crestal family today. So lastly, did you like what you saw today? Have you thought, I would love to spread the message of Jesus across the globe? Then go to crestal.org/give to do just that. Spread the message of Jesus across the globe. God bless you. Also, I want to invite you to come next week. As a matter of fact, don't just come by yourself. Have a party with your friends so that all of you guys can praise God together. Come along with Crestal next week. We know that your time is precious, so we thank you so much for joining us today. We don't take it for granted. You could be doing so many other things this Sunday, but you decided to spend it with Crestal. So we thank you. So lastly, we love you. God loves you. Never give up, never give in, and keep the faith.